So Lord Iltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written. So check out the top link in the description. Though let's start, will we? Be me, Paladin. Be not me, be order undivided. Casdor Glamdring, Orshama, Julian of Sigil, Andre Silverthorn, Peregrine Horsu Rider, and Senkit Zarathustra, Paladins one and all. With the hobgoblin cleric of the unspellable god defeated and the church restored, the paladins ride once more into the night back to the halfling village to rest and recover from the hard-won battle, and to make ready for the coming counterblow from the Legion of Cluny. Yet despite their best efforts and the best of their infiltratory aught, they do not yet know just how mighty a blow the legate has reached out to smite them with. For this night, 4 Decanum and 50 Singulares prepare to march out at dawn. On their left flank is 20 soldiers, skilled and ruthless, led by the veteran Primus Pilus Scythia, and on their right 20 more, led by a Judas yet unknown. In the center, 50 goblins slaver for blood, the dancing madness of the jester and sorcerer Fimbimbulus bringing them to a fervor. That night, the paladins rest and the war host readies itself. As the dawn blooms across the blackest sky, the fading vineyard of Darkeacher throbs with expectation. It is a blood dawn, a red dawn, the dawn of a day for slaughter. The thud of boots trample as 4 columns march smartly down, the beat of drums keeping every soldier marching in time. The red morn glints on their weapons and armor, some old yet well maintained, and others freshly forged of bronze that once rang proudly from a high tower. Today the bell broken shall ring out on dwarven steel. Behind them the flat green feet of lesser goblins patter infrequently, any stragglers finding the sharp crack of the whip and the snarl of a cursing overseer. While they may grovel and cower, their wicked hearts beat hotly, long tongues lick thin lips as rusted daggers and dented scimitars glint in the glades. Today they shall strike their hated foe, and tonight they shall feast on their still warm flesh. A stag lifts its head at the sound of the war beat and quickly rushes away, light hooves leaping gracefully through wooded fen to a top grassy knoll. The light of the moon and unnatural cleverness in its eyes. As it bounds it bugles out a warning, a planned signal that its lady shall know. Andre meditates in the coming dawn, aside from the village, sat cross-legged in a favored tree, lips speaking silent prayers to her gods. Creator, grant me victory, Selhaedin, watch over me, heavens, shield these little ones from the ravages of the dark gods. When she hears the warning, her amethyst eyes open. There is a sort of excitement to them, a momentary taste of the thrill of battle, to feel the blood of her foes upon her blades, and charge once more in the name of her goddess. She rises and drops from tree to shadow, and as she prepares to depart, she offers a silent, singular prayer to a goddess her mind no longer knows but her soul shall always remember. Watch over me again. Watch over me once more, Dark Mother. Silver hair runs in dark shadow, blurring across the dawning day, back down into the village, a warning on her lips. Arise, arise halflings, arise my comrades, evil comes upon us, a day for battle dawn. In the village, warriors rouse themselves from their breakfasts and don what armor they have, padded shirts and wooden shields swiftly sewn and hewn. Ancient weapons reborn and the blades that once so harshly oppressed come to hands as they assume their positions. Already, their champions are arisen. Casdor and Senkit leave their tent and set their separate ways. He shall go to the forest, to ride out again and break the enemy with his mighty hammer. She shall remain, to rally the defenders and hold against the tide, an immovable anvil for the foe to break upon. The bone hilts of Avory lie warm in the hands of his champion as Peregrine, ancestor of Bolger the Horsu Rider, stands at the center of the trench line. He shall not depart from his people, godless though they might be. Godless again stands the son of the heavens, with blade and echo of his father's in his hands. Aside Casdor and Warpig he rests atop his mighty steed until the time has come for the Lord of Conquest to ride forth and shatter the foe. Death, swears the betrayer, death to his foes, death to those besides him, death to his false comrades, death for the sake of the one whom he still owes loyalty, even beyond the gates of Hades. Silver and red make a beautiful tragedy as the crimson light blossoms across the reddened stand of Silverthorn. Strong and mighty is her shaven bow, and silver are her arrows. Redded are her favored blades, openly worn, for the boot is too far to risk now. By her stand the hunters, their deadliest prey coming unto them with slaughter in heart. They can all hear the drums now, and all stand ready as the four steps from the woods to the clearing. Forth then comes an emissary, there to bring silver words of iron chains and stone altars adorned with the skulls of the innocent. He opens his mouth, but no words shall be heard this day, for a bow sings before him. A shaven bow sings, and in that song is the promise of a new age, an age without the terror of the conqueror, an age of peace and prosperity. Perhaps this is the promise that this song of rebellion brings, but with it sounds the creaking of ancient and terrible gates. Henceforth peace departs, and blood comes upon the land, for the gates of Jornis are open, the dogs of Mars bay havoc, for henceforth, there is only war. Scythia watches as her emissary falls, an arrow in his throat. So be it, the bloody maid states. Let there be death, she cries as she raises tall the banner of the goblin god and orders forwards her force. Death, she is answered, though not by her troops, but by the valorous small, a cry of defiance, of hatred, and of cold acceptance that today there shall be no quarter. Death, again the halflings cry, for the briefest moment, even the hardened butcher gives pause at this most unusual sight, then she shakes it free and dons her dragon helm as the left flank advances. Yort heads his own flank, wearing no helm and marching forwards with no fear on his face, merely a hard-set determination. Behind him his men have long grumbled at their leader being naught but a mere munifex before today, but even they salute his courage. The same cannot be said for the goblins, who hesitate at first at the sight of even these slapdash defences, until the whips crack and the jester urges them forwards. Stab kill! Stab kill! All glory to Mimi! Henceforth they begin to charge, fire on the left with arm, give Senkit and your comrades as much aid as you can, Undri says, as she looses into the oncoming wing of the retaliatory force. Silver slashes red as a soldier falls mid-charge, and is stepped over by his brothers. The halfing archers follow suit, and the sun twinkles between the shadows of falling shaft. Shields are raised, protecting the most of the force, but still some smaller shafts slip through to wound. Blood spatters the grass, through the shower of projectiles, Scythia charges on. Clad head to toe in full plate, she is all but invulnerable to the halfling's assault. Onwards she plunges with two at her left and two at her right into the halfling's flank, hoping to break through there, circumnavigate the defences, and roll up the rebels with the other flank while the goblins hold them in the middle, crushing the impudent midgets in jaws of sturdy hobgoblins. Today though, the fangs of that monster shall find themselves broken upon the indomitable iron that is Chult's rejected daughter. For there at the edge of the halfling line to counter any such a bleak attack is Senkit Zarathustra, the immovable knight of devotion. Gladius and Morningstar clash, and shield locks against banner. Hoof and boot step forwards and dragon helm slams into horned head. Eyeball to eyeball the two warrior women strain against one another. So, the slaves think to sell their souls for freedom, Scythia remarks before shoving back, forcing Senkit to retreat and deflect two slashes so swift that they seem as blurs. I am afraid to inform you that those are not there to sell. The halflings belong to me and the Horde, mind, body, and soul, she declares before lashing out with the standard, striking Sen in the face, bruising it. The infernal paladin is undeterred and responds with her mace, while Scythia slips the first blow, the second strikes her armor, blunt force crunching it to leave a serious bruise of her own on her forearm. They never have, and they never will. She responds, clarion voice raising her challenge above the field of battle. The hobgoblins move around them. On their left, a pair discovers the hidden trench by falling into it. The halflings are upon them in a moment, restored maces turning bloody again as they crunch through armor. Two more try to go around, only to be denied by Senkit's striking shield and seeking mace, sending one to the floor and the other to the grave. The goblins hit the trench and fall, only for their friends to step on their heads to get over. The halflings descend and meet them. Physically they are almost evenly matched, likewise both sides have salvaged weapons and next to no armor. Despite this, it is no stalemate. Not only does the trench grant the goodly folk an advantage, today is their day of retribution. What skill cannot provide sheer fury shall instead, as the hatred of the halflings leaves them unrecoiling from wounds, instead striking on through to deliver telling blows. Blood flows deeply as superior numbers and superior morale strain against one another. On the other flank, Yort and Peregrine engage in a careful dance, each unable to strike the other. However, even as they whirl in a circle of flashing blades and careful footwork, the master is made clearly apparent as Peregrine not only forces the young hobgoblin back, but cuts away at any who draw near, and to touch those blades is death, as even the lightest scratch oozes with dark energy that rots away the body. However, those under Yort's command do indeed have more luck, as they do not face the wall that is Senkit. They instead slip past the halfling's shore to reach and into his kin. Though fearless and furious, noble hearts can only do so much, as the vastly superior soldiers cleave into the line, nearly breaking through. For a horrible moment it seems all is for naught, for the wicked soldiers shall break the line and in doing so begin to roll up and slaughter the rebels, but then two calls ring out, and two heroes arrive like out of legends. From the forests charge two mighty beasts, a great black stag-like nightmare, the devil in its eyes and midnight in its coat. By its side is a great boar, with cold winter in its heart, from which the mortals quail, drawing together in hearths beneath totems of pine and tinsel. Astride them rode two champions, captains of men and dwarf. In one was a blade like a holy avenger, with the wings of an angel for the hilt, and the voice of the divine was in his mouth, and its terror all about him. In the other silver axes gleamed in the hands of a dragon, fire was in his heart and justice in his eyes. About him was clad doughy steel of fine make, and at his voice the stones trembled from the craftsman's tongue. Justice. Justice for the sons of Yondle. Kazdor roars in the tongue of his true father as he falls upon the Groby lines. Axes cleave and the anvil rings out, followed by the thuds of corpses hitting the earth. War pig bellows, bane of Baratheon, tusks gore and bulk crushes. A breaking, an ending, and a new world from the ashes. Julian roars in celestial as blades physical and phantom cleave the foe, who scatter before that beginning of wisdom, terror of the holy. The warhorse whinnies, wrathful beyond its kin, hooves cleaving and trampling once more in wicked glee. A shout goes up from the halflings as they see the flank begin to fall, and the pressure relieved. Redoubling their attacks, the goblins look ready to break already, such is their cowardice, but the whips drive them on. Seeing this, Undri calls upon her forces anew. The whips. Fire on the whips. She demands, delivering two silver streaks to two faces, and two souls to a Chiron. The hunters respond, and while they lack her skill, numbers will suffice as several whips are turned to pincushions. The goblins waver, and then pull back at the jester's cry. Run, flee. Sit a leap. He orders, and the cohort pulls back, a shade too controlled for a full rout. The triumph beginning on the right has not seemed to reach the left though, as hobgoblin swarm Senkit, despite her impeccable defenses, attacks from every angle strike her, and Scythia takes advantage, lashing out with her gladius she rends though the coat of plates and cleaves the paladin grievously, before striking her in the jaw with the standard, forcing her to a knee, down. I shall not be delayed by some infernal whore, bend the knee and die already. Her blade descends like an execution as, only to be stopped by a shield emblazoned with a burning sword. I am the heir of Arvidor, knight of the burning blade and servant of the archangel Zeriel. Senkit growls as she rises, forcing back the blade despite several wounds, her sanguine flesh soaked in blood, both hers and her enemies. I shall not kneel, save before my lady at the end of my duty. Her eyes flare, and she lashes out with her shield. Golden fire surges, and Scythia screams as the paladin flings her back. And only in death does duty end. Senkit roars as she pushes on. Her morning star becomes the blazing sun itself, rending plate and bone in radiant fire. Inspired by her courage, the halfling flank hurls itself at the hobgoblins. Death. They roar their terrible cry anew, forcing the hobs to turn their attention from Senkit. A wicked grin fills Fimbimbulus's face as his jester bells jingle. Now, kill the bosses, he screams with a mad laugh as he hurls a bolt of wild magic into the hobgoblins on the left which slays one and jumps to another, burning his flesh in electricity and dust. The sadistic goblin laughs like a maniac at her dying screams. The goblins turn and fall upon the hobs with glee. Even Scythia stumbles as a goblin strikes her heel. As his forces whirl in confusion around him, Eort steps back away from Peregrine and turns to one of his decanum. Six Emperoranes, he smirks, and as the confused hobgoblin turns, Eort strikes his head from his body. Death, he declares, joining in the halfling battle cry. Peregrine nods approvingly before leaping back into the fray. He cuts down one solider and turns to another, only to see him flung from his feet by one of Julian's mighty blows. The two nod at each other before returning to the slaughter, and three more lie dead. As the sole remaining Decanum realizes the day is lost, he rallies what surviving members he has to him and prepares to retreat, ordering them to fire upon the riders. Julian sustains a wound, but Kazdor receives the worst of the fire, including one long arrow that strikes him in the shoulder and flings him from his mount. For a moment the commander smiles, thinking at least one of them was slain, but his smile vanishes as Kazdor's claw emerges on the other side of Warpig. With a mighty leap, the dragonborn hurls himself over his mount. The hobgoblins scramble to raise their shields, but too late, as they vanish beneath a torrent of crimson-orange dragonfire. Andri observes the turning tides, and furthermore the cruelty of the jester. It is then that she decides that such a creature shall not be allowed to live, and advances, firing two arrows at the midge that catch his attention and send him scrambling before the pale slayer. Treachery. Scythia hisses as she lashes out at the goblins around her. With a single sweeping blow she strikes the heads from two, and then slays another pair before one dives under her attack to plunge a dagger into her heel. She turns and sees Senkit's mace descending. With her wounded leg she cannot hope to evade, so she closes her eyes and braces for death, only to be surprised as Senkit instead crushes the goblin, before flatting another and kicking a third into the mud. Wretched creatures. Do not defile this contest between warriors with your treachery. She orders the green-skinned creatures back. Cowed by her fury, the goblins slink to find other prey, joining with the others to destroy the remaining hobgoblins. Scythia looks at Senkit confused before the latter reaches out and catches her arm as it pulls away. A light touch of healing magic flows between the two and mends the Bilus's heel, before Senkit lets go and steps back, readying herself again. For a moment the two warriors look at one another. Why? Scythia asks finally. Honor. Senkit responds. Scythia looks at her, and in spite of herself, smiles. A thing I thought too long dead. I had thought to capture you and see you brought low for your defiance, but in light of such a rare treasure, I shall merely slay you. I would have your name though, that I might remember our contest. I am Senkit, daughter of Zarathustra, and I would have yours to remember you by. I am Scythia, Bilus of Cluny's Legion. It was a privilege to face you. Go swiftly to your gods without disgrace. And you also, to the glory of Acheron. For a moment, the two warriors, each badly wounded to near death, prepare, each knowing that the next wound they receive shall be their last. Even among the chaos and butchery, there is a peace. Then boot grinds and steps, hoof leaps and trails of scarlet flow behind twin blurs of steel orange and burgundy. There is a ringing, and then a sound like breaking glass, as Senkit not only blocks Scythia's blow, but shatters her blade altogether. For the instant before her death, Scythia closes her eyes at total peace, before Morning Star and Golden Fire blast her head from her shoulders and her body to ashes, leaving only a faintly glowing and slightly mangled suit of armor. The banner of the Legion falls, and breaks in two, the blood of its soldiers drowning the red hand of the Goblin God in a sea of untraceable stains on the once white cloth. As the jester scrambles away from another silver arrowhead, he turns to Andri with hate in every fiber of his being. This is not over, elf thing. He hisses before he vanishes into invisibility and runs into the woods. Between the goblins and halflings, the remaining hobgoblins are butchered. They neither ask nor give any quarter. The paladins pull back and focus on healing the wounded, but Senkit refuses to be healed until all others are cared for. When it's all said and done, they have no spells left to heal, so Senkit finally allows herself to fall unconscious and be carried inside. In the aftermath of the battle, it is found that 12 halflings and 30 goblins have died, along with all the hobgoblins. Without any leader, the goblins agree to aid Eort in defeating the legate on the provision that they will be allowed to live in the abbey afterwards, which Kazdor agrees to after much crumbling, though they have to go to Sen's bedside to talk with him, as he, along with Andri, refuses to leave. After Sen finally regains consciousness and is healed, they finally set out to recover the weapons. The slaughter is such that pretty much everyone can have two weapons, and several chain shirts are stolen from the dead whips. And the goblins fight over them for some time until Julian intervenes and has them draw straws for them. Kazdor on the other hand vanishes again, having last been seen carrying Scythia's suit of plate armor. After some searching, they find him back at the chapel repairing it before he orders Undri, who found him, to go and get Sen. Lass, if you're planning on continuing to do such daft things as fight off an entire enemy army's flank by yourself, you're gonna need better armor, and ye and the groby woman are about the same size. He insists. Besides, winter is eventually going to show up and you'll freeze in that southern gear. Senkit is somewhat uncomfortable to change her gear, but agrees. After another day and night of constant work, Kazdor has refitted the armor to fit the tiefling. During this, Julian prepares new plans for assault. Undri and Peregrine train their troops, and within the Bloodystone Abbey, Cluny sits upon his throne, one eye poring over the maps of his defenses. So the traitor had shown his true colors, and had paladins to boot, one of whom had even slain his beloved Scythia. It was inevitable that they would attack his abbey. Let them come. He would show them that they were not the only ones who could call upon the fury of the divine. Be me, be not me, Kazdor, Peregrine, Undri, Snecket, Julian, and Eort, order undivided. For several long weeks they have traveled the summer lands, and now the time has come to at last assault Bloodystone Abbey, seat of power for the local Hobgoblin Legion. They have stripped away their defenses, slain or recruited half their forces, including the elite cleric Heraclius and the Primus Pilus Scythia. And now the time has come to break the abbey and destroy the legate, Cluny. Julian lays out the plan. First, the paladins and archers shall approach the abbey from the woods by night and remove the sentries with ranged attacks. Second, the paladins shall climb the walls and move to the back door of the gatehouse. Afterwards, Eort and the goblins they have won to their side shall run for the gate with the halflings on their tail to try to trick them into opening it. After the gate opens, the party shall breach the gatehouse from behind to keep the gate open and allow them to move in their full force. Once the force is inside, they shall send in the goblins to the camp to try to turn as many as they can before launching a lightning assault to wipe out a surviving loyalist. This will leave them in control of everywhere but the abbey itself. From here, they will assemble to catch any attempt at escape and use their superior numbers to keep them inside while Julian uses his wings to fly to the top and let down a rope, allowing the paladins to get inside and attack the legate. Once the legate and the command staff are dead, the party will proceed downwards while their forces pressure the entrances, hitting the enemy from both sides and forcing them to surrender. It is, in theory, a good plan, a clever plan, perhaps even a merciful plan compared with their original idea of just filling the lake with poison, but it is a plan with one major flaw. It assumes the party can kill the legate. It is night, 3 nights since the Battle of the Turning Sword, where Eort revealed his colors and together with the traitor goblins helped the party shatter half the legion. 3 nights of preparation, planning, drilling, and training. 3 nights of constant work for Kazdor, reforging not only the Pilus's plate, but also a substantial amount of hobgoblin armor to fit the halflings. Joke himself now wears the bronze that once rung from the tower in the abbey in ages past. Tonight it shall ring again. Concealed in the shadows all around the fortress are Undri and her archers. Unbeknownst to any, tonight their arrows are not the same. Tonight she has gifted them an assurance of killing. In the dark between the days, Undri has slipped out of the village, and in the woods gathered nightshade, death nettle, toxic mushrooms, and other such poisons. She has ground them together into a potent natural venom and coated her charges arrows in them, cautioning them not to scratch themselves and swearing them to secrecy. They must not fail, even if it may offend Senkit's sensibilities. Julian readies his crossbow, and Peregrine his sling. Kazdor has taken a set of javelins from the fallen Groby and now hefts one. The sentries walk the walls, silhouettes clear in the full moon and stars, and Undri readies a special whistling arrow tuned to play the song of a nightingale to sound the beginning of the assault. Bows are drawn, targets set, breaths taken, and the nightingale sings. Black shadows on the dark blue sky, a score and more of silver strings slipping through the air to their targets. Several fly wide, but there are enough arrows to land stinging blows, and enough of those for the poison to do its work. Undri is in fact the last to fire as she must swap her whistle arrow with a normal one. She silently curses the songbird, having not thought that an actual nightingale might screw up her plans. Still, it is to her benefit this time, as one hobgoblin stays standing, he opens his mouth to shout a warning, but never gets it. Two arrowheads lodge in his lungs, and the wind that would have called to his comrades of the danger is stolen from him. He gasps a few times, struggling to fill deflating lungs, and then sinks to his knees. It will be a few seconds more before he dies, perhaps a minute if he is particularly strong, but his last words have been spoken, and he shall die drowning in his own blood. With that near disaster averted, the second part of the plan begins as the party rushes forwards to the base of the wall. While the 20-foot cliff of solid sandstone is too sheer for even agile Undri and Peregrine to climb, it is not so tall that a paladin ladder cannot reach it. Kazdor is at the bottom, followed by Julian, then Sen. Careful where you place your eyes, Undri warns the dragonborn as she clambers up. If you're at all symmetrical, I might as well be looking at an anvil even if I did look up. The dragonborn grumbles at the elf. Now hurry up, your bloody prude, plate armor is heavy. With the two lightest members up, they are able to brace themselves against the crenellations, and while they don't exactly pull a Senkit up, she doesn't pull them down hauling herself up. She then turns and helps up Julian. Kazdor backs up, and takes a running leap, but isn't able to reach their outstretched hands. It seems this dragon cannot fly very well. Julian begins mentally cursing himself for not being on the bottom since he can fly, but Undri instead gets out some rope and tosses it down. We really should have thought of this sooner, she says as she helps haul the heavy dragonborn up. Alternatively, we could have used Sen's tail if we didn't have any rope, Julian comments dryly as he gestures at the unusually long and thick appendage. Try it and I'll turn you into chicken dinner, bird boy, she responds. Peregrine curiously picks it up and gets slapped in the face with it for his trouble. Let's just deal with the hobgoblins and not waste any more time ogling the freak, shall we? Senkit grumbles irritably as she takes up her position near the edge of the gatehouse and waits for Yort. Sure enough, here he comes right on schedule alongside a whole parade of goblins behind him and some particularly angry looking halflings after him. Open the gate for the gods' sakes, he shouts. And apparently it's believable, as the gate starts to creak open. Now, Kazdor hisses and the paladins move out. Guarded by such high walls and with a half-score men supposed to be walking atop them to view the surrounding woods, the hobgoblins in the gatehouse never expected to be attacked from the other side of the walls. As such, though the door is sturdy and there is a bar and lock available, it is not being used. Kazdor leads the way, surprisingly quiet for his size, and one of the hobs guarding it has a moment to shout a warning to the others and draw his blade before the massive dragonborn is upon him. A whirlwind of axes split him into several pieces before he can even scream. At the gate, the leader of the commander turns from the breathless Yort to heed his comrade's shout and goes stiff as a blade stabs him through the back to the front, a hobgoblin blade. He is alive just long enough to know that he is betrayed. The last of the three sees he has no chance against Kazdor, and unafraid of being called a coward, flies past, ducking under his strike and pushing every once of his being for the door. He makes it through, and then goes flying forwards, wind flying from his lungs. He turns on his side to see familiar armor glinting in the moonlight. Scythia? He asks confused. The Morning Star says no. With the gates opened, the party's small army makes their way inside the quiet abbey. The great walls of Bloodystone Abbey are surpassed. Next, the goblin camp. The party call in their mounts and mount up for the lightning strike while the goblins slip inside their camp. That is, except for one paladin. Where's Shirley? Julian asks as he looks around and sees a golden retriever without a diminutive knight on his back. Uh-oh. They say at once when they realize Peregrine is now in the camp, having slipped into the goblin camp to try to convince them. Well, if he gets torn to pieces, it's his own damn fault, Julian says as he crosses his arms and sighs. Redeemer's gonna redeemer. Inside the camp, an argument is beginning to formulate as cowardice and self-interest combine with the naturally disagreeable nature of goblins to formulate the beginnings of what could very well be a riot. Into this mess steps Peregrine, who raises his hands and voice and begins to speak. Friends, goblins, lend me your ears. Several dozen flat feet turn to stare at the implacable halfling, who smiles like a champion. Here you stand arguing amongst each other, brother and sister against one another, but ask yourselves, who is your enemy? Only the straight-up divine intervention of his magnificent elf keeps them from answering you. Is it each other? Tell me, whom among you was the one who cast you from the abbey, though there be room enough for all? Whom among you decided that you shall be chattel beneath the heels of the hobgoblins? Let him stand forth and be answered for. Whose gods cast down your pantheon and left you a scattered people? Who was it that decreed that you must leave your homes and your families, to depart from peaceful life unto unending service in this host? Who is it that lays claims falsely to your lives, to your labor, to your very souls? I tell you, it is not your brothers or your sisters, it is no goblin at all. How long shall you allow petty disagreement to keep you at the bottom? How long shall you live enslaved to your so-called betters, and even still to the weakling bully of a god that bears his whip? Is this what you desire? Hovels and shanty towns on the outskirts of the conquests you fought and bled for, the scraps tossed from the table of the hobgoblins and the conqueror. Is this all you are worth, to be less than scum, never to be anything more than the lowest of the low? To be forever despised and reviled by your allies, to be though of as rats? The goblins begin to listen, in spite of themselves, and look around, look at what was built by the free, and what they are allowed to build. I say thee nay. I say let this be the end of that age, let this be the end of such a state. The paths lie before you are thus. You may attack me, and because of your great numbers, you may even yet strike me down. What then? A continuation, a lifetime beneath the boots of others, and then an eternity before the whip of the bully god. Or, rise above this wretched station, forsake this wicked hierarchy. You know this, those fruits of villainy are never anything but servitude and hatred. Turn from this, and let this day be sung in history of when the noble history of the goblin people began, ever upward until the day when your children, your grandchildren, they are called heroes and champions, worthy as any other. That speech, perhaps because of the divine will behind it, perhaps for persuasive rhetoric, or perhaps simply because this halfling, this knight, this hero dares to believe in goblins of all creatures, stirs their hearts and minds, and for a brief moment they dare to dream that one day they might be slaves no more, that their children might be something more, that there might even be a day when they can be called heroes in their own right. For a brief shining moment, the goblins stand and see a choice before them. Well done indeed, an old and rich voice speaks, and that voice makes the whole of the host flinch. Slow clapping of metal gauntlets echo as a hobgoblin steps into the light of the goblin's cooking fire. He is tall and almost noble looking, broad yet lean, neither as heavy as Senkit nor as mighty as Kazdor, but still his presence makes him seem a titan. His armor gleams in the firelight, and an axe, fearfully and wonderfully forged, hangs at his side, and on his side is a sturdy steel shield. On his back is a great cloak of a dire bear's skin, a princely garment paid for with an eye and a harsh battle. His face is handsome in spite of his many scars, in fact it may be more handsome for them. Doubtless his noble visage would be the envy of many kings, and his mighty frame that of adventurers and savage lords. He wears no helm, but instead a simple eye patch covering his left socket, and his other silver eye stares with cold cunning. This is the legate, the breaker of legions. This is the champion, the slayer of heroes. This is the scourge, the bane of abbots. This is Cluny, lord of Bloodystone Abbey, knight of the great conqueror. And fear begins to close on Peregrine's heart as he realizes that this is a trap. The guards at the gatehouse did not expect to be attacked from within the abbey, and so they did not lock the door. The paladins did not expect to be attacked from without, and forgot to shut the gate. The last halflings to enter the gate, the archers, whirl as they hear the sudden thunder of steel boots behind them as the remaining hobgoblin legion charges them from behind and falls upon them. They scream out into the dark as the horde fills into the door and traps the rebels inside. The paladins whirl in total surprise, and Undri turns dark as she remembers the mocking words of a jester. This is indeed not over, goblin. You shall suffer for this, she promises as she draws her bow. I must admit, your strategy has been quite good, and you behaved just as you should have to defeat me. Whomever your strategist is, I salute him, Cluny says as he steps forwards and draws his axe, but I am afraid that your little incursion is at an end. Singulares, deal with him, he orders the goblins, but they do not move, either for fear or for indecision. Perhaps it was a better speech than you realized, Peregrine answers as he draws his own blades and eases into his stance. Avery, Cluny says with a smile. It has been 20 years since I slew the last champion of the Withered God. It shall be good to do so again. he says, shifting into his own stance, and Peregrine feels a cold fear try to take hold, but he does not quail before it. For a moment, Hope and Terry look one another in the eye, feet bare and booted shift, and the fire of the goblins crackles in the night. Then they spring. Andri whirls in the night and calls blade to hand to plunge into the melee, ancient words upon her lips. Elbereth of Faragorn, reveille young Goliath. And as at the ruin of the halfling village, the forest answers, binding the hobgoblins in silver vines like spider thread. Order with me, protect the halflings, Julian shouts as he draws his blade and charges, cleaving down the bound soldiers before their friends can free them. Kazdor. Senkit shouts as she moves to help him get Peregrine and guard our rear. We shall hold them, she promises, reforged armor and old mace glinting as she falls into the fray. Alas. Eort, with me, Kazdor says as he runs for the goblin camp with the hobgoblin beside him. It is not too far, but still he prays he is not too late. Peregrine strikes first and strikes hard, lunging low beneath his opponent's swipe and opening two festering wounds in his legs, before those same legs lash out and kick him back and an axe comes down. Peregrine raises his swords and parries, and light flares with the sound of a thunderclap. Peregrine goes pale as Glunny reverses his axe and smites the halfling across the face, sending him sprawling with ears ringing. So that's what that feels like, he chokes out. Hurry up, guys. The hobgoblins do not simply climb over their friends like the gnolls did, but instead those on the other side of the obstruction shift to two-handing their long swords and hack away the vines, freeing their friends and then stepping aside as others rush in. Despite being so heavily outnumbered, the paladins do not give an inch. Despite sustaining blows, Julian rolls past the cup to his shoulder and strikes ahead from its owner's shoulders, using the momentum of the blade to cut into one another before whirling to cut through sword, armor, and hobgoblin as his phantom blade takes its place beside him. Senkit bears perhaps the harshest fury of the hobgoblins, as they recognize whose armor she is wearing, and fall upon her with all wrath. Fortunately, that armor is also enough to ward her from their strikes. She responds without fear, every motion pushing through one attack to another, hurling hobs back and splitting apart bodies with mighty swings. Andri receives once more the ancestral hatred hobgoblins have for all her kin, but this time she is better prepared and a shade more cautious, not allowing a single blow to fall. She dances between their dangerous yet inaccurate blows and shows just why a careful strike can be as deadly as a mighty one as she slits throats and severs arteries. Kazdor hears the thunderclap and recognizes the kind of power it represents all too well. He runs on, already at top speed, towards the sound. Tell me, laddie, is this Clunny? Yes, Eort responds grimly as he rushes on. Clunny is a paladin of the Conqueror. Lightning and darkness dance off one another as Peregrine and Clunny go back and forth, swiping, dodging, parrying, grazing, each well aware that a single mistake will cost them their lives. Each is a master of their art, both good men, but both know that a big good man will eventually beat a small good man, and that Clunny's armor is troublesome for such small blades to defeat, even if they can slip past his defenses. The goblins watch in awe, unwilling or unable to betray their master, yet still holding on to hope against hope that he might fall as the two figures clash in the firelight. As the hobgoblins push forwards once more onto the thin line of the crusaders, their charge is blunted by an unexpected source. A shower of projectiles falls upon them, wounding several as the halflings pick up the boughs of their dead comrades and fire into the oncoming horde. The heroes take heart, and though the odds are against them, fight on all the more furiously. Julian stands proud, his mighty blade and long reach keeping the wide center of the corridor clear, keeping the hobgoblins from getting close enough to strike down the rallying archers. A small pile of mangled bodies is forming around him, though his own blood flows freely, golden ichor swirling into strange patterns among black blood, streams of light in an ocean of darkness. Senkit stands by the wall as the wall, unbreakable and immoving, though hobgoblins swarm all around her and wounds slow her. She does not fall, using every weapon she can in the tight melee. Shield and mace, tail and hoof, every part of her a weapon to hold back an army. Opposite her, radiant even bloodied, flows Andri. The elven woman stands where the moon shines and knows no fear, for her goddess is with her, a smile on her lips and life fully in her eyes. She does not diminish even as she whirls, dealing death with death drawing nearer with every blow she takes. Still she stands, a song upon her lips and a bulwark against terror. And to that bulwark, to that wall, to that whirlwind of fury the halflings rally, and they fill the gaps between the paladins, giving them much needed breathing room. In that moment, the plot of Cluny failed. While he had planned to turn the abbey into a death trap, the paladin's swift action had turned the gatehouse into a massive force multiplier, preventing the full horde from attacking at once. And without their overwhelming numbers, they could not win. Whether they would all live to see that victory was another matter altogether. Khazad-dûr and Liort finally raced into view of the duel between the two champions. Khazad-dûr sized a javelin from his back and hurled it, striking Cluny and throwing him off balance. Peregrin saw his chance and leaped, blades leveled to pierce the legate's throat. Only the warlord's armor saved his life, as the blades deflected, but in that moment fate bent, and they deflected into slim cracks and slipped through, pumping Cluny full of dark energy. The warlord roared and threw Peregrin off with his shield, bringing his axe down again, but for the third time the world twisted and his blow struck air. But he had another blow, and as he reversed his axe for that second blow, the scales of karma were balanced. It was a textbook hit, perfect even. Thunder roared, blood and bone and ruined chain fountained, and the twin swords of Avery vanished in a flare of power. There were two clacks, and then a thud, as two bone-hilted swords hit the dirt, followed by the ruined body of Peregrin Horsey Rider. His chest was utterly destroyed, torn apart as though hit by a cannonball, barely even recognizable amid a wash of red jelly. So riven was his body that his heart could be seen, still boldly and determinedly beating despite all odds. Nat 20, maximum damage. The battle still raged at the gate. Julian still swung, blood still flowed, hobgoblins died and the paladins held, but all that was distant now to Khazad-dûr. All of it was so very far away, gone beneath a tidal wave of fury, a melting, searing hate like magma from the core of the earth, white hot and overwhelming. His body burned, the dwarven mail turning red hot from its wearer's own internal heat as axe sprang to talon. Khazad-dûr spoke an oath, not in his thickly accented common, not even in the dwarven tongue his mind knew best. He spoke as a dragger, in the language his mind had never learned but his blood had never forgotten, and his words were power. Cluny. By Bahamut, by Shemat, by ancient Io, by the blood of my ancestors, by the strength of stone and by the purity of fire, by Maradin, and my soul's father, and by Clangdeen, my only lord, thus I swear, I shall kill you. Cluny felt in that moment a chill, though the night was warm and heat washed out in waves from the enraged dragonborn such that the air around him shimmered. He felt the chill of death, and his breath left frost upon his lips at the sheer might of Khazad-dûr's vow of enmity. The other paladins sensed the divine power manifesting, and knew what it meant. For a moment they considered turning back, but they would not let this be in vain, and so, in the name of their fallen brother-in-arms, they brought furious vengeance upon the hobgoblins. Pulsing crimson, slashing silver, radiant golden flame. The fury of the paladins was greater and more terrible than anything the hobgoblins had ever seen. Julian moved like a solar, each blow turning bodies to red mist, leaving mangled armor in his wake. Undri flowed like lightning, and neither blade nor bone remained unsevered before her blades. Senkit was perhaps most terrible of all, horns in flame, hooves grinding dust into the air around her. Armor was broken and bodies burned to ash as though the fires of hell itself sprang forth from her. What then shall hobgoblins do against such reckless hate? Naught remained but to flee, for even the iron discipline of that race has limits, and to see so many of their number laid low by such mighty forces was too much even for them. They broke, and forsook the abbey forevermore. Yet their captain remained, and he and Khazad-dûr flung themselves at one another. Axes clashed against each other and met, and though weakened by Peregrin's fell blows, Cluny was still a mighty man of valor indeed. He caught the other axe on his shield, but the axe went through, and Khazad-dûr ripped it from his arm, carving a deep rent in Cluny's flesh and armor as he did. He swung again and Cluny reached up and grabbed him by the wrist, holding the larger man back. The remaining paladins turned and rushed to their frenzied, pounding down the courtyard in their haste. Thunder rumbles again as Cluny smites his foe, and there is a crack as Khazad-dûr's arms break. Face it, lizard, I'm stronger than you. The wounded warlord mocks, and then flinches as Yort moves around and strikes him in the shoulder. For my father, the younger man hisses, as light flares on his blade. Silent was the power of the Aught, but no less devastating as his smite made a ruin of Cluny's back, and the warlord fell away as Casdor came on anew. The ringing of the anvil and the thunder of the heavens roared out against one another twice more, before Casdor slipped the legate's guard and steps forwards, slamming the axe into his face. The warlord goes stiff, and then one last smite sounds into the dark, and Cluny's head explodes, his body falling dead onto the dirt. The party arrives to see Casdor collapse into a seat, breathing heavily from exertion, still glowing from his rage. The dragonborn reaches out a hand and lays it upon Peregrine's laboring body, still desperately holding on. The others lay their hands upon him, and the healing magic flows. Even Eort, somewhat unsure of himself, assists, and soon enough the flesh re-knits and the haze lies open. Well, all of you here, it's quite heartwarming. No wait, that's Casdor, oh. He says as he wiggles away from the still stove-hot dragonborn. Good to know we can cook eggs on you if we ever lose the frying pan. Casdor looks at him sternly, and then just grins and throws back his head in a long and rumbling laugh of relief. A shame nearly dying, didn't he force ye to reconsider your terrible sense of humor, yo wee bastard. Speaking of senses of humor, one might wonder where the jester was. Watching, of course, things had gone partly according to plan. The dumb lizard thing had killed Big Boss, but the elf thing and her friends were still here, including that slave thing. And worse still, it had won proper right folk over to it. The tiny jester wanted to scream in frustration, but instead simply slipped on invisibility and slipped away. The abbey will still be there in time, and the pale Winter Queen will be quite interested to know that elf things were in the forest again. Oh yes, yes, oh yes, yes. And so the paladins retired for the night, entering the Zarnistone Abbey for the first time, and in triumph, the halflings and the goblins looked at one another with great unease, but for the moment the presence of the paladins and the euphoria of the night was enough to keep tension silent. We really ought to rechristen this place. Bloodystone Abbey seems too grim for a place like this, Senkut considers as they enter the great hall, the warm walls rising upwards above many long tables. Save that theological debate for the morning, I'm tired. If you have to do it tonight, then just call it Redwall or something like that and be done with it. Julian grumbled as he headed in the general direction of what was either the dormitories or the cellar. Redwall? Seems a little too obvious. It probably had a name before the goblins took it. Maybe we can find that, Andre suggests. For once I agree with Sir Chicken Nuggets, R. Amofsky. Casdor grumbles as he wanders off to bed, which for him probably is in the cellar. The remaining paladins look at one another and shrug, before bidding one another good night, and wandering off to find proper beds for a well-earned rest. Be me, be not me, Casdor the just, Peregrine the wise, Andre the kind, Julian the cunning, Senkit the indomitable, and the Aught that rebuker, or so the bards shall call them in ages yet to come. Tonight they have won a great victory and taken Bloodystone Abbey, breaking the Legion of Cluny and slaying the champion of Mglub yet. Though perhaps the greatest conquest is that of the hearts of the goblin singulares, as the wretched folk have begun to turn from wickedness, and yes, I can hear Julian snickering at that statement as well. As the exhausted and bloodied band of crusaders flops down in the nearest beds they can find, occupied by a giant warming pad called Casdor or otherwise, they are swiftly claimed by the quiet net of sleep. This night, they all dream, and all dream the same dream. Again they stand outside, but this time atop the walls of the abbey, now blazing with fire like the light of the sun, but the fire does not burn them. From atop the walls they look out into endless and dark night, dark without stars or moon to light it. In the forest past the edge of the fire's light they all see clearly the writhing, strangling infection. All now see the dark vines, even Julian, pulsing with Bon-Eater upon the land, upon the trees. Andre can see a stag running in the night, agile even through no less tangled than the flora in the creeping curse. Then, they sense a presence besides them. Senkit sees the tiefling from before besides her, and he turns to the abbey and raises a bright finger at it. Seek us. Seek that which has fallen. Seek the story unforgotten. Heir of Flame, take up our sword once more, he commands. Casdor looks to the west and sees a stone dragon lying broken on the shore, barnacles upon its tail and a wondrous axe within its chest. forged of mithril and inlaid with pearls. Fire burns so very dimly around the wound, and he hears many voices, male and female, but all speaking Dwarvish. Lord of Stone, avenge what was lost. Andri looks to the north and to the east, and sees trees hung in spider webs. In the center of the glade is a crumbling marble statue of an elven woman, who reaches out for her. Her arm falls off as she reaches for Andri, and she calls to her, Wandering Wind, let the gates be opened once more. As she watches, shadow spreads across the statue, marble regressing to insidious obsidian, save the hair. Two pairs of amethyst eyes stare into one another, as the statue speaks words in a language Andri does not know, but still she understands the pleading. As for a mother for her estranged daughter to return, before any more words can come, silver spider webs crack across the statue and strangle it to dust. Peregrine looks into the dark and sees many tiny lights, like fireflies in tar, scattered out across it. In the north and east he sees a great many in a cage of ice. Sword of Water. The voice of a halfling woman commands him, Bring me back my children. Julian looks into the dark and hears no voices, sees no visions at first, until he feels himself drawn far from the walls into the north, to where the old road and the mighty river meet in the ruins of a once great city, godless and without inheritance. Son of Heaven scorned for the mother's sins. A woman's voice, great and terrible, rings about him. What shall you fight for here? You have no gods to fight for and will find no gods here. It warns, but the paladin does not quail. No, you have no time for the defiances of divinity, do you? She asks with a chuckle, knowing the answer. Seek me if you dare, where chaos fears to tread. She challenges him, as the black vines burn with the sulfuric smell of brimstone. The party awakens, and Kazdor pushes off the several halflings who decided the warm dragonborn was a good place to sleep, rumbling and grumbling with enough ornery morning grumpiness to rival Warpig. I'm gonna have to tell Peregrine to wear his folk against using me as a pillow. He grumbles as he pulls on his armor and belts on his axes. Kaz, you are the first man I have ever known to complain about having too many companions in bed. Senki remarks dryly as she pulls on her tunic and dons her armor. The dragonborn turns slightly more red than usual. Speaking of the little fellow, where is Peregrine? Julian asks as he walks out of the privy, still wearing his helmet out of habit. Andri walks in, fully dressed and ready to go. Julian, do you really need the helmet? She asks. Strange habits aside, Peregrine sent me to come and get you. Breakfast is ready. Julian takes off the helmet and puts it by his bunk, fully aware of the stares the halflings are giving him. He pulls out his spellbook. I'll be down in a few minutes. He says slightly self-consciously. Fine, more scoff for me. Kazdor rumbles as he heads out. As Julian studies his spellbook, he is surprised to find that there is a new page in the book, not simply leafed in, but completely new, as though it had been made with it. The paper is of high quality, and furthermore the spell is not written in his draconic or the infernal his mother used, but in a fine hand of celestial runes. He frowns as he considers this, and quickly identifies the spell as one to call forth a familiar. Down in the kitchen, Peregrine has been up for a while alongside Andri, putting the abbey's food stores to good use. A wide collection of grains, flours, and pre-made loaves makes life far easier, and furthermore the abbey possesses many looted spices and sugar. Best of all though is when he discovers a coop of irritable but bountiful hens, and furthermore a small hoard of eggs. With this bounty, the paladins, halflings, and goblins are treated to their first hot breakfast in quite some time, of hot steaming bowls of porridge, scrambled eggs, and toast. Simple, but exceedingly satisfying, Kazdor examines the workmanship on the bowls and spoons. They are all identical, indicating that they were either created using magic, or perhaps a gnomish invention such as an auto-forge. They are simple, but all of rather high quality, clearly not goblin make, and thus were either stolen or perhaps simply were used by the abbey's original inhabitant. As they eat, Peregrine and Andri join the pair in the scoff. You know, we still need to find this place's name. Andri says between bites, I say we wander about and see if we can't find any old records of it. Julian, Peregrine, you two are the most well-read and well-traveled among us. Have you ever heard of this place? Senkit probes the more intellectual pair. And my studies were mostly large-scale history and the arcane. I'm afraid I've heard no mention of this place's name in my books. The Sami lands have been abandoned for a century or so, and it wasn't exactly a densely populated area even at the best of times, so its history seems all too much tied up in legends and myths rather than solid facts, Julian says, sounding slightly disappointed. I've heard stories that supposedly came out of here, Peregrine said, and heard a few more from Mike in here. However, it's sort of garbled. Either there's been a whole lot of times where this place has been invaded and a hero rises to deal with the problem, or it happened once and everyone keeps switching around who the hero was and what the problem was, he says with a bit of a shrug. It's probably a bit of both if I've had to guess. My folk will tell a story 1,000 times and never the same way twice depending on what we want to get across as a point. I get the feeling that we are going to be part of one of those stories again. We are Nielaoina Bard to come and follow us around getting in tay trouble. Niway. I am Nie keeping me eye on some frilly loot lover. Kazdor rumbles aggressively. Don't you dwarves have a long history of using songs to keep pace when you mine a march? Undri questioned. Aye, we chant the old histories and remember the old grudges. It's Nie Bard's song though, we tell it like it happened. Nie frilly turns o phrase or unnecessary elven maids tay rescue and bed. Aye, women can deal for themselves, he grumbles. I'm afraid we probably are going to wind up in a story one way or another. A whole bunch of paladins on a merry crusade to retake lost lands? It's practically Storybook, Peregrine chuckles. Sort of like that epic about the lizard folk, Rising Dawn was it? Julian considers. Strange habit bards have of slapping names on parties. And why are they always called parties to begin with? Tradition, I suppose. Senkit mutters into her coffee. I suppose they'll slap one on us as well. Probably something silly like the Stardust Crusaders or something. I think that's already a thing, a bunch of monks if I recall correctly. Andri points out. I suppose if we want to avoid something silly we might as well come up with something of our own. Bah. Kazdor says as he wipes his mouth and picks up his dishes. We'll work it out when we've got time. Let's get this bloody place cleaned out first then deal with this wee bit of nonsense. With the name discussion left behind, at least in character for the moment, the party splits off and begins to wander the abbey in search of any clues as to its history and identity. Senkit heads to the walls and the gatehouse, finding the place where she stood in the dream. Scouring the top of the wall, she does find something unusual. Covered by a layer of Zandi dust, she brushes clear a section just where the tiefling was standing to find a small brooch in the shape of a sun, carved from what looks like silver, set into the stone. With a small bit of effort she manages to pry it free from its engraving to examine it more closely, and realizes that it is in fact a medallion. The medallion is far too sturdy to simply be made of silver, but it lacks any hum of magic about it. No words are carved on front or back to identify the owner, but it was very clearly placed in this stone and hidden by dust for a purpose. Peregrine heads outside and wanders through the orchard, between the thick glades of apple trees, ripe with fruit. He sees a clear progression of ages, indicating that each tree was planted several years apart. He follows this to the youngest tree, which even still is a rather old fellow, though nothing before the ancient and massive sort at the other end. He searches around the tree, trying to find out why they were planted at such seemingly random intervals, hoping to find some hint, until his barefoot steps on something cold at the base of the youngest tree, and he turns to investigate. Brushing aside the dust, he gasps as he finds that what he stepped on was a plaque set into a small stone at the base of the tree. It reads, in common and a language he doesn't recognize, Abbot Thib, a good and generous man even in the harshest time. Claimed by the Great Plague, he provides even in death. Rest in peace. Peregrine rushes to the next tree, and finds a similar plaque, the resting place of an abbess. He rushes to another, and then another. He swiftly realizes that this orchard is not merely a supply of food inside the walls, but is in fact the final resting place for the leaders of the abbey. Each abbot and abbess lying peacefully beneath a fruit tree, their body providing nourishment for a new life that shall in turn nourish others. Kazdor heads down, following a staircase from the great hall into the comfortable underground. Inside, he finds a long table covered in reports with 13 chairs. The paper and quills still lying there seem to be various reports, and it seems this room was where the legate held conferences. The entire room is made of the same warm sandstone as the walls and main building, but is generally comfortable and cozy. On the far side of the room is another door, and next to it a grand tapestry that covers the entire wall. It is a massive cloth edifice showing Glubyet's conquest of the other goblin gods and the beginning of his great war with the orc gods upon Acheron. Kazdor is obviously displeased at the existence of such a tapestry and walks over to it. After confirming that there is nothing else flammable nearby, he sucks in a breath and bathes the remarkable piece of pagan artwork in fire. He smiles slightly smugly to himself, thinking that if they wanted to keep their art they should have made it a bit more permanent. He turns to investigate the other door, when, out of the corner of his eye he sees the flaming tapestry was in fact hiding something. He turns and chuckles slightly, as it seems the original designers of the abbey had the same ideas on art as him. Hidden behind the tapestry, which was presumably hung to hide this, is a massive stone carving into the wall itself. This is clearly dwarven work, as only they could paint such a picture in solid sandstone. The carving depicts the building of the abbey, by dwarves and humans working together, under the watchful eyes of a stout-looking dwarf lord and a human wearing a mighty sword. As the scene progresses, the human and the dwarf defend the abbey from a horde of various monstrous races, goblins, orcs, gnolls, and creatures more obscure and profane that Kazdor cannot recognize rush in a great swarm against the pair, only to be flanked by an elf from the woods and a halfling riding on the river. At the far end is the most recent work, looking to be perhaps 200 years younger than the original piece, showing the human from before, standing with sword in hand in front of a multitude of different humanoids of all races, all standing behind with the same sword in their hands and the same determined stare in their eyes. It is a truly beautiful piece, although it does contain an imperfection, one only a dwarf or one raised by them might notice. In the final panel, the first hero's sword is missing the center of its crossguard. Examining the sword's depiction with the other heroes, the crossguard would appear to have a small symbol of the god Pella for its center. Kazdor smells a hidden door, and to confirm his suspicions, he quickly departs, moving to go find the one other party member with the senses to detect it. Andri is exploring the main building, finding mostly dormitories and other such rooms, but she is pleasantly surprised to find a large suite of rooms that would appear to be a hospital. These rooms are immaculately clean, even by the hobgoblin's own obsessive standards. The beds are laid with fresh linens, and it is light and airy with several large windows. Further examination discovers what looks to be an alchemy lab, with a small stock of potions, names labeled in goblin. Since she cannot read them, she leaves them be until she can find Peregrine or Eort. In the next room over is a single bed with straps to bind the occupant down. Many cruel-looking sharp implements hang on the walls. It is uncertain whether this is a torture chamber or an operating room. However, considering it was run by hobgoblins, probably both, she transformed the room, which even when cleaned still stinks of blood when she hears Kazdor calling for her and heads over to him. After the situation is explained, she heads down to the carven hall and examines it. After several long minutes of study, she confirms his suspicions. There is indeed a cleverly hidden secret door here. Julian follows Eort, while also looking like he's conducting his own search. Despite the young paladin's aid in defeating Cluny, he is still somewhat suspicious of the treacherous Blue Nose. Eventually the pair arrive at the legate's suite and begin to search through it, finding mostly situation reports. In searching his bedroom, they find the leader's war chest, a large padlocked and sturdy oaken box. A solid strike from the Arsimer opens it, revealing a substantial amount of gold, silver, and copper, as well as several precious stones and golden images. It's probably enough wealth to purchase half a small village, but Julian is somewhat unconcerned with it. What are they going to spend it on? Despite this, they leave it alone for now, and continue to search the room. Julian raises an eyebrow when he spots a book poking out from under the pillows of the large bed, and snorts derisively when he discovers it is the rather popular How to Pick Up Fair Maidens. He considers just tossing it back down on the bed, but instead, after making sure Eort isn't looking, slips it inside his bag for later reading. Books are books after all, and he's needed something new to read for some time. He is then incredibly pleased when the next room they search is filled to the absolute brim with books and scrolls. Eort is certain this is the happiest he's ever seen the Arsimer as he carefully begins to look through. Julian's grin grows even wider when he realizes what they've just stumbled across. Volumes upon volumes of recordings, mostly in the form of clearly dated journals from the abbey recorders across history. the newer books are in common, but as he also scans several of the older ones, other languages appear. It seems Celestial was popular at the beginning of the Abbey. Several are written entirely in Dwarvish, and an entire tome, larger than all the rest, is written entirely in Draconic by what looks suspiciously more like a claw dipped in ink than a quill. As he digs in with sheer glee, Julian at last discovers the true name of the Abbey in the recordings of one Methuselah. 7.16. Illegible. Little has occurred of note this day, save that I have discovered the etymology behind our fair Heartfire's name. It seems that there is indeed magic illegible, as I discovered in an ancient, almost crumbling letter from our founder, illegible, to Lord Dwarven Runes, mostly illegible. This place shall have the warmth of the kindly sun in it, a faded and illegible, goodly people I build it for this age and the ages yet to come. So, that is why it is Heartfire and not Hearthfire. I am very pleased to have discovered this, though I fear the paper shall soon become entirely destroyed by age. Heartfire then, Julian muses as he looks at the old book, it itself now almost as ruined by the wastes of time as that letter the author found. Fate smirks at least. He mutters as he puts it down. There is too much here for him to throw himself into for the moment, so he selects the youngest of the books and heads to find the others. As noontime rises, the group reassembles in the hall for a meal and begins to discuss their findings. At Casdor and Undri's report, Senkit's eyebrows jump. Would this perhaps be what was missing? She says, producing the medallion. Casdor examines it, and his eyes go wide. By the Maker's beard, he invokes. This is Mittal, he says as he examines the small medallion carefully, seeming unable or unwilling to let it go. The paladins look at one another excitedly. They all know the incredible value of that particular metal, and while they are not greedy, the existence of such a token indicates that this was once an incredibly prosperous place. More dwarf work to boot. I'll keep find iron signs omi kin, but near place where they'd call home. The Dragonborn says, actually sounding worried for the first time. Still, it's definitely the key. Undri agrees as she looks at the craftsmanship. But the key to what, I wonder? Peregrine says, his natural curiosity piqued. Underground and hidden behind a secret door, whatever it was, they really didn't want it disturbed. Considering I found it where the ghost was, maybe it's his tomb. Senkit offers. I'm not sure. I found where they buried all their abbots. Why would they go through so much trouble to hide anyone else? Unless there was some kind of super abbot, Peregrine says, trying to consider what a super abbot would do with his time. Whatever it is, it should prove useful, though I think I may have found the most valuable point of all. Julian says proudly as he produces his book, the history one, not the dating one. There's maybe a score or two more of these. The whole history of the Abbey once I get time to go through it. Casdor rumbles something under his breath about the inferiority of paper to stone, but Julian ignores him and opens the book. Now, let's see what happened here. He muses as he begins to flick through the pages until he finds where they stop and the book goes blank, and then turns back several pages and his eyes flick across the paper. He reads through the last days of the Abbey quickly, flicking the pages over seemingly every minute. Totally oblivious to the outside world, even when Senkit places an empty mug on his head to test, he still doesn't notice. I've seen men look at their gods and at their wives with less love than that. Peregrine whistles, honestly impressed by the scholarly warrior's focus. As Julian reads, his face grows surer and darker as he comes to the end and sighs, face grave. It seems the inhabitants of this place were wiped out by a plague, he says, though his eyes say that what he read there was far more than that. It struck the land without warning, wiping out almost all the major settlements, spreading like wildfire through anything larger than a halfling village. The people here took in the sick, tried to help them. All they did was let the sickness in. The account had been harrowing, the recorder steadily growing more and more frantic as more and more died, and then as he had felt the symptoms take hold, it seemed he had tried to keep writing, but collapsed, as the last page had nothing but gibberish, ending with a letter that collapsed into a long scrawl across the page. It gets worse, he says, deciding to reveal this last horror. The symptoms were this. Their bodies wasted away, like the life was drunk out of them. Their blood turned black and their veins thickened, until they were, and I quote, like vines. A chill runs down the party's spine as they remember the creeping curse in the dark, and their vision of the strangled land beneath the coils of endless black vines. pulsing darkly like blood vessels. None of us are sick though, and neither were the goblins or the halflings, Senkit raises. We can't get sick, Peregrine reminds her. And the halflings and goblins are probably the descendants of survivors who developed an immunity. The colonists won't have that though. Weren't they sick when we left? Undri realizes, and the party begins to understand why every colonization effort before has failed. Damn. Kazdor curses, blowing smoke from his nostrils. Julian, that book, did they ken even the beginnings of a cure? He demands. Not even close, they sent out people searching but those never came back. Julian says grimly. We're on our own. No, we're not. Senkit says. The ghosts, the visions. We all saw our own, didn't we? The party nods. They must have found something, and now it's up to us to follow through. This is our quest, to finish the job and save this land. We shall not fail. She states, her faith becoming ironclad as the pieces fall together. That same determination spreads across the party as fervor and zealotry banish fear and replace it with the invincible resolve of heroes. The ghost bade me to seek where he rests. Senkit says as she stares at the mitral medallion. I think I might know just where that is.
So I've recently moved Ikbadia merch over to Teesprings and have a few new designs. Listings are below the video and in the description.
Just stop! Just stop it! Stop! No! Just stop it! It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services! It's time to stop!